Realistically, when can we actually when can we start this? When can we, in the United States, without kicking off even worse relations than we have right now with the propaganda war and everything else, really realistically start bringing this back, manufacturing what we need in the United States, controlling that supply chain? Because I know that we also have to have that uncomfortable conversation about the amount of U.S. debt that China owns.
Yeah, thanks very much, Dana. And the answer to your question is we need to start doing this now. And the reason is that the reliance on China is critical. It's not going to get any better. A lot of people in industry that have benefited from having factories in China want us to increase our dependence on China at this point. For instance, they want President Trump to give relief on tariffs and all the rest of it. That's absolutely the wrong direction to go. You know, it's unfortunate that we got ourselves here, but what we shouldn't be doing is going to China and asking for more assistance, because China right now has been extremely hostile to the U.S. It's tried to tar our image around the world, said that we were the origin of the virus, that the U.S. Army brought it to Wuhan.
Yeah.
We really don't have very much choice. China is driving this, and we've got to start protecting ourselves, as President Trump said yesterday, with this American independence agenda.
Right. We're talking with Gordon Chang. You can find him at GordonChang.com and on Twitter at Gordon G. Chang as well. A lot of timely stuff up there. You mentioned as well how the propaganda coming from Beijing is that the United States really ultimately they place this in China. They place this in Wuhan. But I mean, we know that that's not true, and that this was a problem that has actually been watched for quite some time. The SARS epidemic, when SARS broke out, there was discussion about the wet markets and also Beijing's communist control, the top-down control, and how that contributed to the spread of that almost pandemic, and how everyone said it was just a ticking time bomb, but nothing was ever done. China didn't alter, to my knowledge, didn't alter any regulation, any way that they governed or anything to prevent it from happening again.
Yeah, not for more than 2 weeks, because at the time of SARS, which was 2002, 2003, Beijing said it was going to close down the wet markets in the country. Well, they didn't. Mm. And many people think that the coronavirus started in a wet market in Wuhan, which is one of the two theories that are out there. The other, that it was an accidental release from a virology lab, a P4 biosafety unit. So there's been remarkably little done. And what we have seen, Dana, between 2002 and now, is the Communist Party also just with this extraordinary suppression of information. It was the same then, it's the same now. If there's any difference at all, and it might be a minor difference, it's because of social media exists now and it didn't exist then. Mm-hmm. But basically the party's response is 100% the same.
I have been amazed to see some of the headlines with respect to the accusations that were flying around from China to the United States. And I was also amazed to see the head of the World Health Organization, and this was, I think, the very beginning of January, praise China for its response to this pandemic, when we know very well that they were jailing doctors, they were deleting reporting from newspaper websites, they were persecuting journalists, they were deleting data, they were telling researchers to stop researching for vaccines for this. And all the while politicizing that emergency pandemic meeting that the World Health Organization was hosting by excluding Taiwan, who I would think everyone could have learned from, considering the amount of travel that takes place between those two countries. Why is it that no one ever points that out, at least in media? I'm starting to see some of it now, but that's never been a real focus about, just to the extent that China has politicized the World Health Organization.
Yeah, this is really important, Dana, because the WHO actually hindered the world's response to the coronavirus. So, for instance, it delayed declaring this to be an emergency, and it declaring this to be a pandemic. And clearly it's a pandemic. Now, countries could have acted a lot quicker if they had moved according to their own instincts, not waited for the WHO, which downplayed this. Mm-hmm. The head of the WHO, Dr. Tedros, actually said that China's response to the coronavirus showed the superiority of the socialist system.
Right.
And if you live in a democracy, you've got to be very concerned about that statement.
Yes, very concerned. And we've seen that not just obviously with the WHO. We've talked previously about just what we've seen with Hollywood and everything that the everything that really China is involved with here in the United States, and the whether it's the WHO, whether it's them hiding the virus's genome sequencing. Ultimately, because this is such a problem that to be realistic, both political parties, I think, have allowed to it's allowed it to grow. How in the world can we even start in dealing with this problem with China? And is there a reason? Should we have a healthy fear of how much debt of ours that they own? Or is there anything that they even can do that would further jeopardize our markets? I mean, what, how would we handle this, and what do we need to watch out for?
Those are great questions. First of all, the one thing that we can do is President Trump is about to sign an executive order drafted by Peter Navarro, his trade advisor, about the robustness of the global supply chains, especially pharmaceuticals. We're going to see a lot of action from the president on that. And that's a really important thing because we're so dependent upon China and indeed also India, but especially China for making pharmaceuticals, making the compounds that go into pharmaceuticals. They really have a chokehold on the supply chain of a number of critical things like antibiotics, blood thinners, the rest of it. You know, with regard to debt, this is the one thing I don't worry so much about. And the reason is China's been selling our debt anyway because they've got to support the renminbi, their currency. And because of the way the global financial markets work, they cannot really dump dollars and treasury obligations without killing themselves off first. So they've threatened this since about August 2008, but they don't really do it because they know, first of all, the mechanics of the financial markets won't let them, but also because they realize that they're going to be the first victim and that we are so much stronger and will be able to survive it. But in general, you know, the answer to your question is, we cannot forget the maliciousness of China's response to us in the coronavirus epidemic, and we've got to start separating ourselves, cutting the links with China. As unfortunate as that may be, we've got to do it to protect the American Republic.
Yeah, we definitely need to do that, and sooner rather than later, because I can't imagine this getting any worse than it is right now. The talk of China perhaps paying any sort of reparations for this pandemic that they contributed to. I don't know do you find that realistic?
No, it's not realistic. There's a case in Florida right now that is suing China for something like $12 trillion or so. It's very difficult to maintain a suit against a foreign government because of the sovereign immunity. Also, you got to get jurisdiction over China, and China is not going to submit itself to the International Court of Justice or any other tribunal on something like this. There are, I think, when you think about the legal justifications, yes, they're there. But mechanically, you can't sue China. But we can impose costs on China. President Trump can do that without going to a court. The Congress can do that without going to a court. And that's what we need to do, cutting those links, imposing costs, because China's acted abominably in all of this and has really killed people and put other people's lives at risk.
Yeah, thousands and thousands of people have lost their lives because this pandemic was allowed to grow to the extent, well, to become a pandemic, quite frankly. And going back to, you know, what we initially began our conversation on, just the medicines, you know, et cetera, I was actually, and I almost feel silly for saying this, because it wasn't until we really started getting a lot of headlines and actually discussing the resistance of certain existing antibiotics that I realized the extent that the grip that China has on that supply chain. I kind of wonder if a lot of other Americans were sort of in the same position and not really realizing that. I mean, you're looking at what it's something like 90% over some of the ingredients that are in our antibiotics come from China. And I didn't realize just ibuprofen and vitamin C. I mean, these are medicines that are critical to day-to-day life for Americans. That's a scary thing that I feel like we've really been apathetic about, that we've allowed it to go to that extent, to their advantage.
Yeah, of course. You know, there is a woman named Rosemary Gibson who co-authored a great book, China RX. And that book's been out for a couple of years. People just ignored her. People have ignored the entire problem because many elements of the American society just profit from China. And so they try to drown out voices like Rosemary's. It's important for us now to start thinking about what we need to make inside our own borders, because we need to understand that we can't rely on other countries. Even some countries that are close friends have denied us things which are critical to us. So this is, you know, maybe not as economically efficient, but nonetheless, in order to maintain sovereignty, we've got to do it.
And have it work better in the long run. Last quick question for you. I know China was saying that their numbers were now on the decrease, that they were on the other side of this virus. Do you think that can be believed, because they've haven't really been honest about their data prior to this?
Yeah, I think China is about to start a second wave of infections. We're starting to see infections go up. They are lying from all that we can tell. Yes, it's less than it was in February, but no, it's not on the downswing. It's on the upswing now, Dana.